Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church today. We welcome every one of you. May the Lord bless you and appreciate our visitors visiting with us today. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, appreciate you tuning in to get this hour coming up. We want to be an inspiration to you. And I believe we will by the help of the Lord. I'm going to speak today on the subject, saved and know it. That's very important. Saved and know it. Do you know that you're saved today? Well, if you're not sure about that, you can know it, and that's why I want to help you from the Word of God. Maybe many of you out in the radio listening audience, you wonder about your salvation. And if you follow me, I can help you from the Word of God today. That's where our help comes from, is from the Scriptures. And I'll be reading from 1 John chapter 5, that's way over in the New Testament, way over toward the back at page 1325 in the original Scofield Reference Bible. I want you to turn then, follow me in the Word of God. If you're not getting our daily broadcast, if you tune into the station where you're now listening, you can get the daily broadcast Monday through Saturday at 12 o'clock noon. And many of you out in the radio listening audience, you're probably listening now that you don't listen through the week. Maybe you don't know about our broadcast during the week. We're heard 7 days a week on this big giant station here in Athens. We're now in our 40th year of daily broadcasting from Athens. We thank God for the privilege, the open door to be able to get out the gospel. God put us on the air. God's raised up some over the years to help us pay for the time. God keeps a record of every effort put forth. God keeps a record of every dime given by His children. Help keep the program on the air. God has that record. And we'll all face it at the judgment seat of Christ when we come to rewarding time. A lot of people in heaven today, there's people being used of God today, and people love the Lord because as a result of this radio ministry. Went on the air in 1948, on the first day of September, I believe, in 1948, and been on there every day since. And we thank God for the open door, the privilege to get out the gospel. God gave the word, and great is the company of those that publish it. So we work just together in getting out the gospel. But you need to know where you stand before God as an individual. This thing of being saved is absolutely too important for you to play around about it or wonder about it. You need to know about it. There's some things in life you can doubt and take a chance on, but taking a chance on your soul salvation, that's something you don't need to do because you're gambling with the most precious thing that you possess, and that's your soul. That's you. And that's far more than money or lands or wealth. The Bible said, what would you have if you gained the whole world and lost your soul? Your soul is more valuable than all the world. What would you have if you gained the world and went to hell? You'd be in sad shape. A lot of people like to vacillate when you begin to talk to them about the matter of their salvation. Kind of like the little boy. Man asked him, said, son, are you saved? He said, well, I have religion. He said, well, what kind of religion do you have? He said, I have the same kind my daddy has. Well, he said, what kind of religion does your daddy have? He said, he has the same kind that I have. He said, well, what kind of religion then do you and your daddy have? He said, we both have the same kind. So you never could get a direct answer, but you need to be able to give a clear-cut, direct answer in regard to salvation. If you're not saved, you're not going to be a soul winner unless you got that thing settled. Back when they was building the Golden Gate Bridge in San Francisco, California, 23 people fell to their death while working on that bridge, and then they raised money, some thousands of dollars, to take a net and swing it underneath that bridge just in case somebody else fell and be caught by the net. And 10 people fell and was caught in that net. Their lives were saved. But what was so obvious about the matter is that they worked a whole lot better knowing that net was underneath them in case they would fall, they wouldn't fall to their death. And so they turned out a lot more good labor in finishing that bridge. Now the same way in serving God, you're not going to be effective and you're not going to be the soul winner of the type Christian that you should be unless you got something nailed down. And that's nailed down should be your soul salvation. Know that you're saved. Now let's get some help from the Word of God today and see where we stand. And I want you to turn to 1 John chapter 5. Some of you out in the radio listening audience, if you've been doubting or baffled or vacillating about whether or not you're saved, yea or nay, you don't know, then I recommend that you read 1 John chapter 5. Read it over and over again and look very closely at God's Word. Now, God can't lie. And what God says in the book is true. It's God's holy, infallible word. Now in 1 John chapter 5, page 1325, verse 1. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Now let those words sink in for just a moment. Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God, and everyone that loveth him that begat him also that is loveth him, also is begotten of him. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. For whosoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. There are three that bear witness on earth, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and these three agree in one. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is God which he hath testified of his Son. He that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a lie, because he believed not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record that God hath given to us, eternal life. And this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son hath not life. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Now the Bible says here in verse 13, let's look at it again. Look at it now as I read it. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. That verse of Scripture says very clearly that you may know that you have eternal life. I'm going to read it again. Come on out there and read it with me. Read it out loud, will you, along as I read it. These things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. Well, I'd heard a few of you reading it kind of low light, but just so you read it, that's the main thing. Now, God wants you to know that you have eternal life. I've run into people and talked with them about spiritual things, about the soul salvation, and they have said, nobody can know whether or not he's saved until he dies. That is not true. Now, if you wait until you die to try to find out whether or not you're saved, you may miss it. You need to know that down here. There's some things you need to know down here on this earth. You need to know it now. And that's why I'm bringing this message. I'm going to give three thoughts. Number one, why you ought to know you're saved. Number two, why some Christians doubt the matter of being saved. And then number three, how you may know that you're saved. Now you keep that thought in mind. Number one, why you ought to know you're saved. Now without the assurance, there is no joy in serving the Lord. How could you be happy? And how could you serve God if you didn't know you were saved? You couldn't be happy about it. There'd be no joy there whatsoever. If you went about wondering and doubting as to whether or not you're saved, you got nothing to shout about. You have nothing to rejoice about. You got to nail that down and know you're saved. 1 John chapter 1 and verse 4, these things write we unto you that your joy may be full. He's talking about the matter of knowing that you're saved, that your joy may be full. Without assurance, there's no soul winning power. Now you go out and try to win a man to God, and if you don't know you're saved yourself, you don't have any power to deal with that man, because there's a doubt in your mind, and then the Holy Spirit is not going to use you very effectively unless you know that you're saved. Now the God will honor the word, but you need to know that you're saved in order to have real soul winning power. Used to be a preacher, an outstanding preacher. The devil aggravated him every day about the matter of whether he's saved or not. Every once in a while he'd say, all right, Satan, you telling me I'm not saved, I'm going to get on my knees right now. In case I'm not, I'm going to ask God to save me. And he did that many, many times before he really got his feet on the ground. And he did that to try to keep the devil off of his back. And the devil will worry you and bother you about the matter of salvation. Now, you need to keep this in mind. You don't usually doubt something that you don't have as a general rule. Now, if you had a $10 bill stuck in your shirt pocket and you occasionally might reach up there to see if it's still there, but if you never had it, you wouldn't think anything about it. Now, chances are, if you doubt occasionally about the matter of being saved, as a pretty good indication you are saved. Just about every Christian that's really saved, he might not admit it, but somewhere along the way he wonders, or that doubt comes to him. He begins to think about it and he wants to be sure about it. That happens to preachers and everybody else, most every Christian. I've heard people jump up and say, well, bless God, I got saved. I take you right to the spot and got as big a thing as God in you, ought to know it. And I know right what happened. I can tell you the second, I can carry the place. I know the time. Well, a lot of people mean well many times in making that statement, and that may be true to a certain extent. But everybody doesn't have that type of experience, as we show you as we move along in the message. Without this assurance, there's no reality in serving God. How can you serve God in reality and let it be real to you if you don't have the assurance that you're saved? You need to know you're saved, then it'll be real. Now, two men on the road to Emmaus talked about Jesus and his crucifixion. All of a sudden Jesus came along and walked along with him and began to talk about things in the Old Testament and how he must come and die and be buried and rise again. And later on, when they found out he was the real true Messiah, see, they were doubting, they wondered what he really was. They said, did not our heart burn within us as he talked with us by the way? Without the assurance, there's no real motive to fight the devil. Now, we find some in the Bible that doubted, and we're going to talk about that in a moment. There's two or three in the Bible that doubted about some things, and you might kind of fit in that category. But you need to know you're saved. You ought to know that, because that gives you the real dynamic punch to serve God. And the matter of salvation, when it comes to God's word, is plain and simple. But you must mean business with God, and God will do exactly what he said he would do. Now, you got to measure this, gauge this by the word, not by experiences, not by feelings. You must gauge it by the word of God. There's a man one time came down to join the church, and the preacher said, well, would you give me experience? I want to know why you came and how you know that everything's right with God. Well, he said, last night I heard something scratching under my pillow. And said, that's why I know that I'm right with God. I heard somebody scratching under my pillow last night. Well, the pastor said, I recommend that we accept this man into our fellowship, because some of you back there never heard anything scratching under your pillow. And so he went in and took him in. Well, salvation is not by some kind of experience, out experience. It's by what God does for you to receive as we move on into the message. Number two, why do some Christians doubt? Now remember, you don't usually doubt something you don't have. Before I got saved, I never did doubt whether or not I was saved. Before I was saved, it never crossed my mind. But since God saved me, there's been times in my life when I've had a battle with this thing. And if a preacher will be honest, he'll tell you, preachers all over this country tell you the same thing. Some of the greatest preachers in America today will tell you there comes time when the devil will catch them and try to make them doubt as to whether or not they're saved or called to preach. That happens. And if that happened to great preachers in the land, don't be surprised if it doesn't happen to you once in a while. You don't usually doubt something that you don't have. Now, some people doubt because they do not know the Word of God. If you don't know anything about the Word of God, then the devil will take advantage of that and make you doubt as to whether or not you're really saved. That's why you ought to read your Bible. That's why you ought to listen to the preacher. That's why you ought to follow him in the Word of God. That's why you ought to listen to me very closely today. Because if you don't know the Word, then of course the devil will come along and have you doubting because you can't get your feet on the ground because you don't know what the Scriptures has to say about it. Some doubt because they know not the Word. Now, we find in the Bible that John the Baptist, that great Baptist preacher, preaching repentance, baptizing a lot of people that came to him, and then he pointed out Jesus and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God that taketh away the sin of the world." Jesus came to him, and then he baptized Jesus. Later on, when John was put in prison, he began to doubt. He sent a committee back to ask Jesus if he was the real true Messiah. Was he the real Savior or not? Are you really the one to come? Now, you wouldn't have thought that John the Baptist, that great preacher that baptized the Son of God, saw the Holy Spirit come in like a dove lighting up on him and hearing him talk and so forth. You'd never dream that John the Baptist would have doubted about that. But John doubted that. He had a doubt about it. He had to send a committee to find out whether or not Jesus was the right one. Was he really the Messiah? I think one reason he doubted is because he figured Jesus might deliver him out of prison if he was the real true Messiah. I don't know that that would be correct, but it may be. Now, Jesus didn't say you go back and tell him, "Yes, I'm the Messiah." He didn't say that. Jesus said you go back and tell him that what I'm doing, I'm performing miracles, raising the dead, the poor have the gospel preached to them. You go back and tell him that. And when you tell him that, then he'll know what the answer is. And they went back and told John what Jesus was doing. And John said, "Well, he's the one, all right. That's him. He's a true Messiah." That was the man in the Bible by the name of Thomas. Old Thomas, one of the disciples, and he started doubting one day. And on one Sunday when they met there in the room and Jesus came in and met with them. Thomas missed church one Sunday and failed to see the Lord after his resurrection, but he met with them this time. And so he said when Jesus came and the others recognized him as to be the resurrected Son of God, and Thomas doubted about it. He had his doubts about it. And he said, "I'm not going to doubt it unless I can see, I'm not going to believe it rather, unless I can see the scars in your hands and your side and so forth." Jesus said, "Thomas, take your hand, son, and put it in my side." And Thomas took his hand and placed it in that scar in the side of Jesus. And what did he say? He said, "My Lord and my God." He didn't doubt it anymore. That's why it's called old doubting Thomas. He doubted as to whether Jesus had been raised from the dead or not, but he didn't doubt anymore. In John chapter 5 and verse 1, "Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God." That's as plain and simple as it can be. When the devil comes to you trying to make you doubt, take that verse of scripture and whop him over the head with it. Just read it over and over again. "Whosoever believeth that Jesus is the Christ is born of God." Now you can't add anything or take anything from that. That's God's plain, simple word. In John chapter 6 and verse 37, Jesus said, "Him that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out." If a man will come to the Lord Jesus Christ in sincerity and want to be saved, You think God's going to turn him away? You think God's going to cast him out? No, no. No, no. If that man's coming according to the word of God, believing on Jesus Christ with repentance in his heart, he'll be saved. God will save him. In John chapter 5 and verse 24, he that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life. Now that's the verse I want you to let sink deep down into your ears. Now listen to it. He that heareth my words and believeth on him that sent me hath everlasting life. You believe in the word of God? You believe the Bible to be the word of God? You've heard the word of God? You believe in God the Father, the one that sent Jesus? Do you believe in God? You believe in Christ? And you say, yes. All right. That's what Jesus said. Now some doubt because they know not when they were really born again, because it did not have the same kind of experience others had. Now you listen to me right now, lest you misunderstand what I'm saying. There's some saved people today, they'll stand up and tell you they know without a shadow of a doubt that they're saved. They know they've been born again. And you can say to them, well, do you know the minute, the place, right exactly where you were when you were born again? They said, no, I just don't know that. But I know I'm born again. Now, many people, children especially, make a profession when they're young, some 5, 6, or 7 years old. And if they live to be 50 or 60 or 70 years, that's a long time from back there when they made that profession. And that may seem a little vague and dim, way that far back. And they can't hardly pin it down. But they accepted Jesus back there when they were a little child. And if you start looking back there trying to find experience somewhere, then you're basing your salvation on experience and feelings and not on God. Now let me drop this one to you. How many of you remember when you were born into your family? I don't remember when I was born in Edward's family. You don't remember when you was born into your family. All right. There may be some of you that's saved, you know you're saved, you've done business with God, but you can't anymore point out the very minute or the place or the hour or the spot that you were born again than you could when you were born into your family. Now let me illustrate what I'm saying. There have been a lot of people that got under conviction and God got a hold of their heart and they wanted to get saved and they got up and started to the altar and came down at the altar and did everything the person worker said do. And if you would ask them where they got saved, where they were born again, they'd probably point out that altar. But really it was back there in the pew whenever they made up their mind they wanted to accept Jesus. Right then is probably when it happened. God gave birth to their soul. But they'd point the altar out. Not only that, there's been people that's made profession after profession in their homes, in churches, in meetings. And they just didn't understand it really, but they did what the soul winner said do, and still they don't understand the situation. And then they start coming to the house of God, and they listen to the Sunday school teacher, and they listen to the preacher, and they begin to read their Bible, and then it happens there. When they really begin to understand what it's all about, then the Holy Ghost gives birth to their soul. And if you'd say, when you get saved, I got saved down there in the house that time that person, worker got out and told me to say the little prayer over in Romans, and that's what I said, and he said I was saved. But really, that wasn't the time they got saved. They got saved later on in life. Now, I use my own experience now, and I'm as honest today as I can be because I want to help you. I told you last Sunday, I believe, how that the preacher came to pay me a visit. And how that my mother had arms around my neck and tears flowing from her eyes on my cheek. The preacher had me by the hand. And they said, Virgil, don't you think it's about time you're getting saved? I said, yes, I'll turn to God. Well, I made a profession right then. I made a profession. I said, yes, I'll turn to the Lord. But you know, if I went back and said I was really born again right that minute, I don't know whether I was really born again that minute or not. But I know what I did. When I got up off the flat of my back and got my little Bible, and when fact to be honest, I lay flat on my back for 2 weeks after I made that profession and read the Bible, and just read it through but didn't understand any of it, because if I was really saved, which I was saved somewhere along the way, I didn't understand it. But what I did, I took my Bible and started to the house of God and listened to the preacher and kept reading that Bible, and I began to understand some things about the things of God. Understand some things about being saved. And if God didn't give birth to my soul right there that day, somewhere along the way he did, because I know I'm saved today. And if he didn't give birth to my soul right then at that moment, I couldn't a bit more tell you why he did give birth to my soul, and I could stand on my head. But one thing I know, I'm a saved man today. And there may be some of you, you can't point out the spot, the very minute, the time that God gave birth to your soul. But you could stand up and say, preacher, I'm saved, praise God, and I know I'm saved by the word of God and the grace of God. I know that God has saved me, and you rejoice about it. But you couldn't carry me maybe to the spot. And a lot of people doubt because they say, well, so-and-so had an experience. And man, the way they acted, they really got it. You could tell why they act the way they acted. They really, really got saved. Now, wait a minute. You don't judge people's salvation by the way they act sometimes. People act differently. Somebody may come down and accept the Lord and cry. Some may come down and accept the Lord and shout. Some may come down, accept the Lord, and get up and walk away as solemn as a judge, and you don't see any different. But God was dealing down in the heart. There were three blind men that Jesus met on the way, and Jesus met this blind man, and he said, what can I do for you? He said, I want to receive my sight. Jesus said, receive thy sight, you're made whole. And the man opened his eyes, and he could see as good as anybody. Later on, we find that Jesus met another blind man, and he said, well, what can I do for you? And he said, I want to receive my sight. The Bible said Jesus touched his eyes, and he opened his eyes, he could see. Jesus met another blind man and said, what can I do for you? And he said, I want to receive my sight. Jesus took the spittle and made a little mud pie of that spittle and dabbed his eyes full of mud. He's already blind as a bat, and Jesus put mud in his eyes. See, God does mysterious things in mysterious ways, and sometimes the foolishness of preaching, we believe it, but a lot of people think it's foolishness. There's a man as blind as a bat, and Jesus filled his eyes full of mud and said, I want you to go to the pool of Siloam and wash. He went down there and washed, came back looking, and he could see everything. Not just surmise one day, those three fellows met in the road, all three of them, and they said, well, Isaiah, I can see you. You see it, or yes, and Josiah, I see you. You see all right. And Zechariah, I believe you can see. Yeah, I can see. I was blind, but now I can see. Yes, I was blind too, and now I can see. Yes, I was blind, and now I can see too. And wait a minute here. I want to hear how you received your sight. One of them said, well, I'll tell you. What I did, Jesus said, receive thy sight, and received it right then. The other two said, you didn't get it right. You didn't get it like we did now. And the other man said, well, I'll tell you the way I got it. Jesus took his finger and he touched my eyes, and I could see. The other two said, wait a minute here. You didn't get it right. You don't have it like it ought to be. That's not the way we got ours. The other man said, now wait a minute, both of you are wrong. Said, Jesus took some mud and put in my eyes, told me to go to the pool of Siloam and wash and come back sin. And I did, and I came back sin. Said, both you fellas are wrong. The other said, now both you are wrong. The other said, now both you are wrong. Now you didn't get it like, now here's a point that I want you to get. Every one of them received their sight. That was the main thing, Brother Carter. They received their sight. Wasn't a matter of how they did it, whether they got mud in the eyes, or Jesus touched the eyes, or just said they received their sight. Now, when people get saved, get born again, they're saved. Some may jump up and down. Some may cry. Some may act as solemn as a judge. Some may have no feelings whatsoever. You're not saved. It's not based on your feelings. It's based on the Word of God. There's a fact, there's faith, there's fact, there's feelings. After you're saved, if you have any feeling, it'll come after you're saved. Doesn't have anything to do with you being saved. That is, you don't depend on a feeling to get saved. You rejoice after you're saved that you're saved. Now, when I made a profession of faith, I was greatly burdened. God saved me. When God saved me, I didn't have a whole lot of different feelings about it at that particular time, whenever it really happened. But I've had some mighty wonderful experiences in the Lord since that time, a way of enjoying salvation and the things of God. And the same thing may happen to you. You maybe whenever you made a profession of faith, maybe God really saved you, you just didn't feel any different. Somebody said, well, if the biggest thing the devil rolls out of a man, the biggest thing God rolls in, he ought to know it. Well, I guess you would, but it doesn't happen that way with everybody. A lot of people say, well, I must have not gotten saved because when I got saved, when that person got saved, they sure did act different, and I just didn't act like that. You base the matter of salvation altogether on the Word of God. What did God say? God said, repent and believe on Jesus Christ. By faith you accept Him. That's what God said in the Bible. That's what you believe. And so you sometimes doubt because of these things. And whenever you doubt, and I wouldn't be a bit surprised if not every one of you out there had at times when you doubted whether or not you're saved. And you don't doubt something is a general rule that you don't have. When the devil comes trying to make you doubt, you just take John chapter 5, 1 John 5, and just read it and whop him over the head with it. And say, get thee behind me, Satan. Believe what God said in that book. Don't wait for a feeling. Don't wait for electricity to run down your back. A man one time said he wasn't going to get saved. He had a feeling. Sitting out in the swing, and a lightning struck, knocked him about 20 feet out of the swing. And he said, well, I think I'll go ahead and get saved. Now I got the feeling all right. Now, you don't have to wait till lightning strikes. Now, if you had to depend on feeling, when people come to the altar, I got a ball bat inside of my study here. I'm not going to tell you what I got it back there for, but you may have a pretty good idea. And I got a ball bat hanging back there. And if you had to wait on a feeling, you know what I'd do? I'd go back and get that ball bat, and I'd give you a feeling. And when I got through giving you a feeling, the feeling situation would be solved. Now, you're not saved by feelings. You're saved by faith in Jesus Christ. I'm going to quickly give you a few scriptures, and I want you to remember these scriptures and jot them down if you want to let you know that you're saved. Now you'll take these scriptures and listen to them and jot them down. They'll let you know that you're saved. Now how may you know? You may know you're saved by the Word of God. First John chapter 5 verse 13, these things are written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know you have eternal life. Romans chapter 10 verse 13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Is that what you did? Yes, preach, that's what it is. All right. And then you may know you're saved by your love for the brethren. Do you love God's people? Do you love this old Baptist preacher here? Do you love one another? Oh, you say, yes, I do. I love God's people. All right. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3, verse 14, we know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abides in death. I didn't love God's people before God saved me. Had no time for them. I respect them, but I cared nothing for them. But when God saved me, they became the greatest people in the world to me, and I love them. Number three, you may know you're saved by the witness of the Spirit. Romans chapter 8, verse 16, the Spirit of God bear witness our spirit that we're the children of God. When the preacher's preaching, you just something in you saying, amen, that's right. That's the Word of God, and it begins to touch your heart and soul. That's the Spirit of God bearing witness with your spirit. If you're sitting back there in the dark, know nothing about what I'm talking about, and my message and what I'm saying is boresome to you, then you better check up. You don't have the Spirit of God on the inside of you. Number four, you may know you're saved by a changed life by the power of God. I'm not the old gambler, the pool player that I used to be. And the dance floor attic, whatever you call it, that I used to be, had the habit of going to the dance floor. Maybe I stated those words, and you see what I mean. Back before God saved me, I loved the old juke joints and the pool rooms, the gambling tables, and living a life that out in the world. When God saved me, all of that changed. Now my happiest time is God's people in God's house on the Lord's day and doing the work of God. You may know by a changed life. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things pass away, all things become new. If you're sitting here and you wish he's over yonder juke joint somewhere, chances are you're not saved. If you're sitting here in the house of God and you wish you were somewhere in some kind of devilment or meanness or sin or out yonder drinking and gambling and cussing, you better get saved. Because when God saves you, then your joy and happiness and peace and satisfaction comes when you are in God's house or reading God's word in prayer, doing the work of God. Number five, you may know you're saved by having your faith in Christ for salvation, plus nothing, minus nothing. Now, you must have your faith in Jesus, not in creeds, forms, ceremonies, religion, but you must have your faith in Jesus. He that believeth on the Son of God hath a witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a lie, because he believed not the record God gave his Son. And this record God hath given us eternal life, and life is in his Son. He that hath not the Son hath not life. It's faith in Jesus Christ, not in some form of religion. Salvation is in Christ. You have faith in Christ. You receive Christ as your Savior. Number six, you know you're saved by desire to do God's will. Now you let this sink down in your heart. Do you have a desire to serve the Lord? Do you have a desire to do God's will? Do you? Do you have that desire? If you don't have it, if it's a burden to you and you don't care anything about being among God's people and being in God's house and doing God's will, you better check up. You may be on the road to hell. Either you're backslidden so far, you forgot you're saved from your old sins. I know you can get so backslidden and worldly until those things have become secondary in your life many times. But if you are saved, you ought to have that desire. Number seven, you may know you're saved by your attitude towards sin and the evils of this world. You love to hear about evil things and sinful things. You rejoice over all this crime and killing and dope and whiskey and gambling, all that. Do you rejoice over that? I'll tell you, it's repulsive to me. TV have turned into our homes. All that kind of crime and violence and wrecked our young people. And they're committing suicide and killing one another. And that's awful. That grieves my heart. And if you're saved, it grieves your heart. You don't love those things. You don't appreciate those things. Would you like for a man to come into your house drunk as a dog and cussing and vomiting all over the house? Do you like that? Oh, that's repulsive. You back years ago, I might have joined in with him. But beloved, listen, I don't like that stuff anymore. No, sir. You should have a changed life by the power of God and desire the pure and holy things of God, the word of God, prayer, Bible study, good singing, good fellowship. That should be what you desire. But if you'd rather be out yonder in a juke joint, out yonder gambling, out yonder somewhere in sin, then you better get saved because you're in the wrong place. And you need to realize that. You need to get saved and you need to enjoy being in God's house. I hope what I've said today will be a help to you. You've jotted down these scriptures, some of you. Restudy them. Any question, we can help you with it afterwards. Be glad to do so. But if you've received Christ by faith and trust him as your Savior, get in the book, get on your knees, serve God. The devil will come along and make you doubt. He'll come along and lie to you. Devil's always been a lie. He'll tell you a lie. He'll tell you you're not saved when you are saved. And just remember that you need to stand for God and the things of God. These things will take care of itself as you move along. Let's stand to our feet.